I would like to call a meeting to... I would like to call the meeting to order. If you could all please take your seats. Thank you. We have a motion to admit. Mr. Schultz.
Mr. Moderator, I move that the following persons be admitted to the meeting: Darren Klein, Maureen Daugherty, Janet Murphy, Carol Ducro, Allison Kane, Stuart Garnas, Maddie Corey, Jerry Newell, Maureen Stevens, Rob Carbone, Jason Smith, Matthew Cooper, John Clifford, Mike Murphy, Daniel McKnight, Mark Clark, and Robert Collins.
On the motion to admit, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. The visitors may enter the hall. While they are entering the hall, a few rules for this evening. All registered voters should be wearing a yellow ribbon. All visitors should be wearing a black ribbon. Please wait to be recognized by the moderator before you speak. If you'd like to speak, you can raise your hand and a microphone will be brought to you. Well, there are two microphones in the center of each aisle. Please shut off your cell phone so as not to interrupt the meeting or the speakers. We'll have one teller for this evening. Mr. Sean Delaney will count the room if necessary. I'd also like to thank our two student volunteers this evening, Maddie Curry and Stuart Kearney. I want to thank them for volunteering to be here with us this evening. All right, Mr. Prisco, if you'd like to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
Please rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I will now call on Town Administrator Michael Gilberto as he wishes to address the meeting. Mr. Gilberto, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Through you, just to members of town meeting, I'll be excusing myself from the room during the deliberations regarding the next two articles out of respect to the town meeting attendees. I think it's important for town meeting to be able to discuss these articles without the incumbent sitting before you so that you can have a freestanding discussion. And I would just ask if somebody could come get me when you're done. Thank you.
Mr. Prisco, Article 30.
Mr. Moderator, can I just make a quick administrative request that everyone speaks closely to the mic this evening? The complaint was from home, watching, cannot hear us. So I think we can all work hard to get close to the mic. Those folks at home can hear us. Good evening, everyone. Article 30. I move that the town authorize the Board of Selectmen to petition the General Court for the special act amending the town charter to change the title of the town administrator to town manager by replacing the references to the town administrator or the town manager, provided, however, the general court shall be authorized to make ministerial, clerical, and editorial changes of the form only to said bill, unless the Board of Selectmen approve amendments to the bill for enactment by the General Court and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to approve such amendments as are within the public purpose of this petition as specified in Article 30 of the warrant.
We have the motion, discussion, recommendations from the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Crisco.
Board of Selectmen recommend.
3-2.
Board of Selectmen recommend 3-2.
For the Finance Committee, Mr. Sobel.
No action required.
Discussion, Mr. Crisco.
The reason behind this article was when you go back and you look at the town district's responsibilities, their managerial in tasks, non-administrative tasks. So we felt, or the majority of the board felt, that changing the title to match up more in line with what the job responsibility is wouldn't make sense, especially since we're already going to go through the process of changing the name of the board. So this is just another keystroke, changing a replace all from administration to manager. And we had one question come in from a resident who's home sick this evening. But I'd like to ask council to come up and just briefly go over the question.
Mr. Clyde.
Darren Clyde, gave you the author, the moderator. So just to
lean in, please, because I can't hear you.
Darren Klein, gave you the author, the moderator. Just to echo a little bit of what Selectman Crisco said, this does not have any legal ramifications whatsoever. The term town manager, town administrator, is not synonymous with the authority under Mass law. The authority of any town manager or town administrator is from the town's local charter and bylaws. So you're not giving that position any additional authority by changing the name from town administrator to town manager. All of that is already in your charter and bylaws, and there's nothing before town meeting tonight to change any of that. I will agree with what Selectman Crisco said, that the current authority of your town manager is much more similar to, the current authority of your town administrator is much more similar to that of town managers throughout the Commonwealth than it is for town administrators. For instance, just by practice, in many cities or towns, the difference between a town administrator and a town manager is a town administrator typically does not have appointing authority, where a town manager does. In your town already, the town administrator has appointing authority. So the change to town manager would be more synonymous with the authority that other town managers have. But again, this change does not affect the powers of the position either way. The powers of the town administrator would be exactly the same for the town manager should make the change tonight. You're literally only changing the name. There was a question from a citizen who is not here tonight. She referenced a statute that talks about for your school collective bargaining negotiations that the Board of Selectmen have a right to designate a member of the, a designated Board of Selectmen to serve as an additional vote for the school committee on school negotiations. The question was, would that change at all if you make the change from town administrator to town manager? The answer to that question is it will not change at all. The statute actually says that the selectmen have the right to appoint a designee, and if there is not a town manager or town administrator, then they should designate one of themselves or support another person to be on the school committee for that purpose. So there is no difference in the statute. It actually says town manager, if there is not a town manager or a town administrator. So there is no difference at all regarding that statute. And that was a question from the citizen who cannot be here tonight.
Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I will try tonight to my wife told me, speak slowly and speak into the microphone. You know, and generally there's a spousal deafness issue here where she doesn't hear me anyway, but she said she couldn't hear me very well the other night. That being said, Board of Selectmen recommended this on a vote of 3-2. I was part of the minority. First of all, I don't believe that there's a necessary change to be made here as far as the town administrator. So we shouldn't have to buy new calling cards. We shouldn't have to change the heading of the stationery or anything else. The charter is very clear. And if you look up here, it says, no change in existing responsibilities or authority. Our charter is very clear. It's a very strong town administrator form of government. Town administrator does all the hiring and firing, signs all contracts, according to our charter. Board of Selectmen basically chooses the town administrator, town treasurer, and town council. That's it, according to the charter. There'll be no change. The other night, we had a brief discussion in relation to changing the name of the Board of Selectmen to the Select Board. I didn't find it totally necessary, but I wasn't overly concerned about it. So it passed, that's fine. I supported the next two articles as far as changing the bylaws and the zoning bylaws in reference to that. But in this particular case, there is no need. There is no need. The charter is clear, the authority is clear, the responsibilities are clear. And if you're talking about coming into the 21st century, and be what they call it politically correct, I'm calling it necessary. Why would we call it a manager as opposed to an administrator, which is gender neutral? So I don't see the need. I would urge town meeting to vote no. Thank you.
Further discussion?
Decided not to go with a commission process. It's lengthy.
It's time-consuming, we didn't feel it was necessary, and I don't disagree with you. This isn't that big of a deal. It's just, we're making a change with the board's name. We figured, the town administrator, if you go back and you read his position description, his role, his responsibilities, it's all based around managerial. It's not based on administrative. It's not an administrative job. That's all we were trying to do. Not trying to upset the apple cart, we're not trying to break traditions. I'm sorry this comes off that way, but that's not what the intent was.
Sir. Well, as you just said, it's no big deal. Well, if it's no big deal, sir, please leave our traditions as they were. There's no need of doing this. There's no need of doing this. Thank you.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Mr. Delaney, I'm going to put you into service right out of the gate. All those in favor, please raise your hands. Motion fails. Article 31, Mr. Crisco.
Mr. Moderator, I move to amend the Code of North Reading General Bylaw by replacing reference to the town administrator, the town manager, as specified in Article 31 in the warrant.
Mr. Chairman, we should probably pass over. Mr. Chairman, we should probably pass over. Can I let in the last vote?
We've already voted. Just let town meeting vote.
We have the motion, discussion, recommendation from the Board of Selectmen. Mr. Crisco.
Recommended, read it to.
Finance Committee requires no action. Further discussion.
Mr.
O'Leary.
Just take a quick look at the warrant. What would the effect be, Mr. Moderator, of this vote based on the last
vote?
Mr. O'Leary.
Mr. Moderator, I ask the chair, in light of the last vote, what would the effect of the motion before us be?
If this motion passes, then we'd have a conflict. But I don't control what motion gets handed to me. If I were on down there, I would hand me a motion that says, I move to pass over.
Mr. Moderator, I concur. I thank you for that. So, Mr. Moderator, how would you like the next motion to be? Do you need a motion to amend, or do you need a motion to amend to pass over?
I
Chairman, should we? Are you asking?
Yes.
Sir.
We have built 5 feet of a drive. Well, from the pin, this is a simple number on the chin. We're selecting to draw a resolution.
We're working on the
issue. It's a lot, it's not as simple as that.
Mr. Prisco.
I will withdraw my motion.
The motion is withdrawn. Mr. Prisco, you have a new motion?
I move to pass over Article 31.
Recommendation from the Board of Selectmen?
Board of Finance.
No action required on part of the Finance Committee. Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 32.
Mr. Moderator, I move that the town authorize the Board of Selectmen to petition General Court for a special act amending the town charter to authorize the first session of Springtown Annual Meeting to be held on any date in June not in conflict with the religious or legal holiday to consider and adopt an annual operating capital budget and to act on other financial matters as well as to consider and act upon such other business as may properly come before the meeting and first session of the fall annual town meeting to be held on any date in October not in conflict with a religious or legal holiday to consider and act on a matter of planning, zoning, subdivision control, building codes, and all other matters of bylaw nature, as well as to consider an act such other business as may properly come before the meeting, including financial matters in the dates for the June and October annual meeting town meeting shall be set by the selectmen at a public hearing held annually during a regular scheduled meeting of the board to be held before March 31st, provided, however, that General Court shall be authorized to make ministerial, clerical, and editorial changes of form only to said bill unless the Board of Selectmen approves amendments to the bill before enactment by the General Court and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to approve such amendments as are within the public purpose of this petition, as specified in Article 32 of the warrant.
We have the motion, the recommendation for the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Prisco.
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Silver.
The Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion? Mr. Prisco.
So the goal behind this warrant article is to try to eliminate some of the conflicts that we've had in the past. For example, this past Monday, we have a conflict with prom here in the school, which gives a lot of challenge. But we also have sometimes some challenges with getting the final financial data from the state. So giving us this flexibility to hold June town meeting when it makes the most sense, when we have no conflicts with the school and their agenda, I think this is a great option. The same for October. When we finish up June town meeting, October town meeting comes very quickly. And if we can get another week or two to allow us to complete some other business and to get some additional information from the state, then I think you'll see that our town meetings become a little more substance and have a lot more to work on. So we would request your support. The board unanimously supported this change, and I think it gives us some great flexibility. And again, we wouldn't set a town meeting without having a public hearing to hear from the public to make sure everybody is aware of what we're looking to do, what the recommended date will be in June and October, so everybody will have a voice and an opinion to make sure you let us know if there's any conflicts.
Sir.
John Rogers, 39 Tower Hill Road. I think you mostly answered that last part, Mr. Crusoe, but is there anywhere where a religious holiday is defined in state laws that we, as a town, just as a practical matter, that we don't have to be deciding what constitutes a religious holiday? There are a lot of religions out there.
Mr. Gilbert.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. So the way we make the determination is based on a review of...
You speak right into the microphone. Sorry.
Is that
yes.
So the way we make the determination is in the January each year when the board traditionally, and right now under bylaw, sets the date for town meeting, we review with the town clerk the schedule of religious holidays that's out there. We consult the town council relative to the significance if there is a question about that. But we do our best to try to avoid any situation where there's a conflict or a potential conflict. Can be a challenge, obviously, because there are any number of different religions that could have a holiday. I think that the challenge is greater in October than it is in June, by virtue of the fact that we lose one Monday to a civic holiday, Columbus Day, already. So, as Mr. Prisco identified, this type of change will give us a little bit of flexibility to not be as boxed into a particular day. Did that answer your question, sir?
Yes, thank you.
Further discussion?
Just to speak directly, sir, to your comments that if it's not broke, don't fix it. It is broke. On Monday, we were competing with a prom. We couldn't have our Board of Selectmen meeting here prior to the town meeting because of traffic issues. Tonight, we're competing with a track meet, a baseball game, and also with an open house at the batch. So we need to have the flexibility to avoid those items, those other events, so we can get more people here. I counted 29 voters here, not counting the people in the front here. Out of a town that has almost 11,000 registered voters, we need to do more that gets more. We need to put these things on better dates where we get more of a turnout. This is sad what I see here tonight. I mean, I thank everyone who came tonight, but 29 voters out of 11,000, I think we need to look at how we're doing things and why people aren't coming to these meetings.
I'm sorry. You've already spoken, so I'm going to go to the south first. But you can go to the microphone. Sorry.
Christopher Lippert, 201 Swamp Pond Road. I appreciate what you're trying to do, gentlemen, but your amendment is totally worth it. You've mentioned several times that you're trying to avoid conflicting the prom. Prom isn't mentioned in what it says. So if that's what you want to do, you need to rewrite this. Thank you.
Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. And Gus, I appreciate your comments. I appreciate your position. I don't totally disagree. But in this particular case, I do. And let me tell you why. You know, this is more ministerial as far as a product of changing times and recognition of, and I see it more as religious holidays. We're recognizing more religious holidays now than we were before. And when we made the change a few years back to move our April town meeting to June, that was in direct correlation to the legislative action or inaction on the budget as to how much money did we know we were going to be getting as a community. So we would, you know, when we were in April town meeting, it was a shot in the dark as to what the House was going to do, what the Senate was going to do, what the governor was going to sign, what was going to go back, what was going to be vetoed. And from a monetary standpoint, it was a nightmare. So when we moved to the first week of June, it really enhanced our ability to better project what our revenues were going to be as far as state reimbursements. So that was a good practical change. This is another one. This is more of a practical standpoint for in relation to conflicts with legislatively, you know, how things are working in that particular year, because it moves the timeline up to March as opposed to January. And again, in March, the board will have a better idea as to what the state legislature is doing and how far they are along in the budgetary process. And when it comes to the state holidays, excuse me, the religious holidays, and the recognition of those religious holidays and the appreciation of those, we have far more to deal with than we did before. So from this particular proposal, I'm fully in favor. We were before the other point of the previous article. I appreciate it probably more than most, but I do appreciate it. But in this particular place, this particular instance, it's more ministerial and it really is necessary for us to act accordingly. I don't necessarily concur with that. I'm not worried about proms. I'm not worried about playoff games. I'm not worried about all that sort of stuff. I'm more concerned about, you know, what's the legislature doing, the timeline of getting our budget set and established so we don't have to come back to a special town meeting to reestablish what that has to be or correct it in October. And from an October standpoint, what the religious holidays are, how it conflicts with the regular holidays and religious holidays, so we can move forward. So I appreciate what you're saying. 90% on board. Thank you. So I would urge you to vote in favor of this.
Thank you, Mr. Sir. You know, in principle, I probably agree with this. The bright speed that I see happening, especially at this town meeting, the Board of Selectmen, gentlemen, are taking the power away from us as voters. And the trend is change, change, change. Sometimes change is good. Other times, there's no need of change. So, the only thing I can say to the board is, before you decide to do some changes, you know, change the sake of change is no good. On this particular issue, I can understand, but I'm upset that you're going through not the proper change. Shown through a charter commission, like our forefathers when they decided to do it, that's really the way they wanted to do it. For some reason, you circumvent our tradition that's been going on for years. Thank you.
Mr. Webster.
Hello, Webster 51, Spruce Road. We're not taking, the selectmen aren't taking the power of anybody's hands. If all 11,000 voters wanted to show up here tonight, we'd have to accommodate all 11,000 voters. This is an open meeting, it's an open town meeting, you're not taking the power out of anybody's hands.
Mr. Prisco.
I just want to point out one thing about the process that you keep referring to. We held multiple public hearings, multiple meetings at Town Hall. They were published, they were on our website, they were in the paper, no one shows up. So to give a description that we're doing things behind closed doors, that we're trying to change traditions because we have nothing better else to do, I take offense to it. So when people start attending our meetings and coming to the public hearings so we can get this feedback, so we can hear this from you, it certainly helps us govern a little bit better. But when the seats are empty, we do the best we can. And I'm going to just leave it at that.
Sir?
Sure.
No, you have to have a microphone, sorry.
I'm sorry I'm offended, but at this point I'll probably offend everyone. Sir, that question we didn't even have a quorum.
We don't need a quorum.
You don't need a quorum for a town meeting?
No, this meeting, first of all, we don't need a quorum for the annual town meeting. This session is a continuation of the session of Monday night. So it does not need a quorum.
So we have a quorum the other way?
We did.
So that suffices this meeting?
We have a quorum tonight. We have a quorum tonight also.
We also didn't need one Monday night. We had one, but we didn't need one. I'll read it.
I'm on the page.
I propose the change.
The Board of Registrar, any number of registered voters present shall constitute a quorum sufficient to any June or October annual town meeting to conduct business between the hours of 7 and 11 p.m. on any Mondays and Thursdays of consecutive weeks until final adjournment.
Okay, stand correct.
Mr. O'Leary.
Just to help those long-term residents that have been here. Now, years ago, there used to be 2% of the registered voters was a quorum of town meeting. And I was a moderator, first elected in whenever it was, 1973. And if you recall, people like us, we were on the phone trying to get people here in order to conduct the town's business, and we couldn't get 2% of the registered voters when it was half of what it was today. So I actually proposed as moderator a charter change to a bylaw change to require those present voting at a regular town meeting. Special town meeting is 150 votes. So we have a quorum. Those present vote. But to your other point, it's important that people are being critical of those who are not here. I will never, ever be critical of those who are not here. It's a matter of choice. If it's important, we have an open town meeting form of government. Both sides of any issue have the same opportunity to come in here and express their opinion, raise their hand, and have it count. I look upon this as ratification that overall, we're doing a pretty good job. People are not necessarily overly concerned as to what's going to transpire here. It's not due to apathy. It's not due to complacency. People are very busy. So I would hope that those that are being critical of those who are not here, stop. And for those of you that are here and choose to come out for whatever reason, I appreciate the input. I want you to be here. Yeah, I want 11,000 people to be here. That's not going to happen. So, this is a beautiful form of government. I don't want to lose it. Let's appreciate it for those that are participating and those that choose not to participate at this particular point in time. When there's something important to them, they will be here. So, in relation to the motion before us, I urge you to vote yes.
Ma'am.
Hi, Elizabeth Rhino, on Williams Road. Quick question. The motion says that the meeting could be held spring on any date in June and annual fall on any date in October, but mentioned it had to be on a Monday or a Thursday. Are we making a change to that when we
but that's the, what I read is what exists today. That is what they're changing. They're taking the Monday and Thursday out. So that's the piece that's going to change. And it's Monday, Thursday if we go multiple nights. That's why it must be Thursday. Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Article 33, Mr. Crisco.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I move to amend the code of North Reading, General Bylaw, Chapter 172-4, admission, quorum by deleting in its entirety and replacing with new text as specified in Article 33 in the law.
We have a motion and the recommendation for the selectmen. Mr. Crisco.
Board of Selectmen recommend.
For the Finance Committee. Ms. Hogan.
No action required.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Sorry, aye.
Did you have your hand up? I'm sorry, I didn't see it.
I have a question. Doesn't this just talk about a quorum? Am I missing something? I'm sorry, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Gilberto, would you like to address the issue?
Yes, Mr. Moderator, thank you. Can everybody hear me? So as was mentioned earlier, there's two components of this charter change that we're talking about. One is actually in the charter and the other is in the town's bylaws. The article that was just approved would allow for the selectmen to set the annual town meeting dates on any date in June or October, not in conflict with a religious or civic holiday. As it relates to the quorum requirement, right now, as the moderator mentioned earlier, we need to have a quorum for a annual town meeting in June or October if it is not held on a Monday or a Thursday. As we described earlier, we're here on a Thursday, no quorum requirement applies. This bylaw provision would remove that requirement for a quorum in order to have the annual meeting, June or October, on a date other than Monday or Thursday. So, for example, it was mentioned earlier that there's traditionally been a conflict with the June town meeting and the annual pre-prom events here at the high school. This provision, in addition to the selectmen being able to set the town meeting date on a date other than the first Monday, they would be able to choose a day other than Monday as well. So, for example, Tuesday of this particular week would be allowed without triggering a quorum requirement.
Sir.
We don't have to have a quorum.
The language. It gets, you know what, I've spoken with Barbara, I've spoken with Mr. Gilberto about it. It gets confusing. But we're not changing our current quorum requirements. When it's an annual or October town meeting, when the registered voters show up, we conduct the business, whether it is 50 or 350. If it's a special meeting, we require 150 registered voters. If we don't get 150, we adjourn. We conduct no business. It's been that way for the 14 years that I've been moderator.
Mr. Moderator, if we don't have
Darren Klein, the current bylaw says that there is no quorum requirement for any annual town meeting that meets on a successive successive Mondays and Thursdays. We just changed the charter to allow an annual town meeting to be scheduled on other days in October and June. All this bylaw change is doing is extending the same no quorum requirement to any annual town meeting date, since the town is no longer required to have their annual town meeting on a Monday or Thursday. Again, the only change is right now, the no quorum requirement only applies to successive Mondays and Thursdays. This will now make consistent the no quorum requirement with the the proposed charter change, so that any annual town meeting will continue to have no quorum requirement, regardless of whether it's on the first Monday in June or October and any successive Thursdays and Mondays thereafter.
Sir.
How are you, thank you.
Please stand and state your name and address for the record.
Nolan Simpson, 251 Swamp Pond Road. I'd like a clarification.
Speak right into the microphone, I cannot hear you.
Clarification, please. Does this change to chapter 117-4 mean that non-registered voters who live in Old Reading, or voters in other towns are no longer allowed to vote in the town meetings in Old Reading?
Can't hear you.
Okay. Does this change in chapter 117-4 mean that non-voters in Old Reading and voters in other towns are no longer allowed to be present at Old Reading town meetings?
Mr. Klein.
No, it does not. It does not change that at all.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 34. Mr. Schultz.
Article 34, amended code general bylaw, snow removal on streets and sidewalks. Mr. Moderator, I move to pass over Article 34 as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Schultz.
The Board of Selectmen recommends passing over.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Hovett.
The Finance Committee recommends passing over.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 35. Mr. Messeri.
Mr. Moderator, I move. Mr. Moderator, I move to amend the Code of North Reading General Bylaws, Chapter 1, General Provisions, Section 1 through 5B, 3, Violations and Penalties in Chapter 23-Dash Animals by adding a new section, Section 23-13-Dash Kennels, as printed in the warrant within the following change. In Section 2313C, omit the words Section 235 of so that Section 2313C will read as follows. C, kennels shall be allowed only to the extent permitted in accordance with the North Reading zoning bylaws as specified in Article 35 of the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation, Mr. Messeri?
Board of Selectmen unanimously recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Hilbert.
There's no action required.
Mrs. Stack.
Thank you. I propose this bylaw, so that is why I am speaking on it. Our current bylaw on animals in our general bylaws lacks any reference or guidelines in total regarding the licensing of kennels. This kennel bylaw would allow the town to keep track of what kennels and what types of kennels are in the town. It would ensure that operating kennels are in compliance with the Mass General laws regarding licensing and inspections. It would require that all kennels must pass an annual inspection by the animal control officer prior to the issuance of any annual license for the kennel. It would ensure that only the types of kennels permitted under the zoning bylaws will be allowed to obtain a license. It would ensure that a kennel may only be established or operate within the allowed zoning districts as permitted under the town's bylaws. And it would also provide for an enforcement process through the building inspector or the police department regarding complaints and violations. It would provide assurance to kennels' customers that the facility they entrust with their pets is in compliance with all state and local bylaws for the safety and well-being of their animals. It would provide assurance to the residents and the community regarding the restriction of kennels only to the appropriately zoned districts and a determination for the number of kennels approved for each site. The bylaw would provide the town with the ability to enforce compliance through the non-criminal disposition process as permitted under Mass General laws, something that we don't have right now. Under state law, the town clerk's office is the licensing authority. The kennel license fee would be set by the town clerk's office, but would be comparable to those of neighboring communities. Under, again, the a statute that was accepted by the town clerk's office can set its own fees. And the proposed bylaw is written so that it would remain in compliance should there be changes to the state law or to the zoning bylaws. If the zoning bylaws were to change and be amended to permit additional kennels than what it currently allows, this bylaw would still be enforced and would still require inspections and licensing and compliance based on the zoning bylaw. And likewise, if the state law changed, this bylaw would still be in compliance with that and require kennel owners to be to follow the state law in that regard. As I said, currently we have nothing that regulates kennels and nothing that requires licensing of kennels. So there could be businesses being operated that maybe are not approved at this point, perhaps are in districts that the zoning would not be permitted to have such a business. So these regulations would help to enforce that and make sure that all businesses are in compliance, kennels are inspected, animals are safe, and residents and the community is protected.
Sir.
John Rogers, 39 Tower Hill Road. Just thank you for that explanation. That's very useful. In terms of the zoning bylaws, I assume we don't have zoning for kennels specifically. So is it just all commercial? What is this called under? I'm trying to get a sense for how restrictive and whether the kennel bylaw goes to the life of the zoned out business.
Mrs. Stats, to answer the question.
Well, you, Darren.
Mr. Clyde.
Darren Clyde, KP Law, the moderator. Excellent presentation, by the way. It is allowed currently by special permit in the LB and GB zoning districts in town.
Mr. Moderator, also in the Highway Business District.
Thank you.
Further discussion?
Under the state law, it states that the town clerk is the licensing official.
So this is not done by
the animal control officer? No, through the moderator, under the state law, the animal control officer must perform an inspection each year before the town clerk or the town clerk's office can issue a kennel license.
Thank you for the clarification.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 36, Mr. Masseri.
Mr. Moderator, I move that the town vote to supplement each prior vote of the town that authorizes the borrowing of money to pay costs of capital projects to provide that, in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20 of the General Laws, the premium received by the town upon the sale of any bonds or notes thereunder, less any such premium applied to the payment of the cost of issuance of such bonds or notes, may be applied to pay project costs, and the amount authorized to be borrowed for each such project shall be reduced by the amount of any such premium so applied as specified in Article 36 in the warrant.
We have a motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation, Mr. Masseri?
Board of Selectmen unanimously recommends.
Ms. Hobart, for the Finance Committee.
The Finance Committee unanimously recommends.
Discussion, Mr. Masseri?
Just a brief explanation. When we borrowed money in the past, the bond premium was used to pay off part of the bond. So if we were going to build some project that cost $50,000 and the bond premium was $5,000, then we would borrow the $50,000 and pay interest on it. We would use the premium to help pay off the bond. Now we can, for a $50,000 project and we're getting a $5,000 bond premium, we only have to borrow $45,000 and pay the premium of that. It's kind of a simplified explanation.
Discussion. Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Article 37. Ms. Minipelli.
Article 37 is to establish a regional school district stabilization fund. Mr. Moderator, I move that the town vote pursuant to section 16.5 of chapter 71 of the Massachusetts General Laws to approve the creation of a stabilization fund by the Northeast Metropolitan Regional Vocational Technical School District, consistent with the August 10, 2017 vote of the Northeast Metropolitan Regional Vocational Technical School District Committee to establish a stabilization fund as specified in Article 37 law.
We have the motion and recommendation for the Board of Selectmen, Ms. Manupelli.
Board of Selectmen unanimously recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Ms. Hovett.
Finance Committee unanimously recommends.
Discussion, Ms. Manupelli.
Just by way of a brief explanation, this is another request that was made by the Northeast Metropolitan Regional Vocational Technical School. At our meeting the other evening, their superintendent David DeBarry, their finance director Jay Pacone, and our representative on the school board, Jean Diamond, appeared and explained that we would like to have this fund established. They're actually requesting all of their participating communities to approve this in order for them to establish this stabilization fund. They have to get the approval of all of their participating communities. There will be no additional assessment. There is no funding obligation. It's essentially a fund that allows them to, subject to a vote of the school committee, put a portion of their appropriation into the stabilization fund for capital improvements. And then they can keep it and can carry over from year to year for the capital improvement purposes. But there's no funding or assessment associated with this, no additional funding or assessment associated with it. They need our vote in order to be able to have this, and they need all the other school districts to vote in order to be able to have this stabilization fund.
Further discussion? Up in the deck. Mr. Evans.
Eric Evans, 3 Sample Lane. Do we know how many other school districts or towns sign up?
We actually didn't ask that, but they're all like us in the process of their meetings, and they're all in the process of their approval process. Didn't really know how many, and I believe they need a majority of their participating schools in order to have this fund.
So we'd be the first one?
Ms. Manupelli.
We could, but I'm not sure. I don't have the answer to that.
Just curious, if it didn't get passed, would they just go by the wayside?
Yes, they wouldn't be allowed to have a stabilization fund.
Further discussion? Mrs. Kepler.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Loretta A. Capizuto, 12 Twain Drive. I'm just curious how this stabilization fund is actually set up.
Mrs. Manupelli.
It would be set up for the school committee. It would be appropriated by the school committee. The appropriation goes into the fund, and any expenditure fund still remains with their school committee, with the Northeast Regional School Committee. So all of this is really an earmark for them. It's a vehicle that allows them to earmark funds for capital improvements and carry them over so that they can save and then spend as need be in accordance with the approval of the school committee. It is not anything that we have a say in. It's something to help them manage their budget and capital improvement needs.
Mr. Klein.
Darren Klein, the moderator. I just wanted to add that if they didn't want to request any money from the town to place in the stabilization fund, it would be from all towns, obviously not just the town of Loretta. It would require them to go to town meeting. So if they wanted any of the towns to put money into the stabilization fund, it would need to come back before town meeting to make that vote.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 38, Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Article 38, approval of Hillview Golf Course Management Contract for term in excess of 3 years. I move, pursuant to General Laws, 30B, Section 12, to authorize the Hillview Commission to enter into a contract for golf course management services for a term in excess of 3 years as specified in Article 38 in the warrant.
We have the motion and the recommendation from the selectmen. Mr. O'Leary.
Board of Selectmen unanimously recommend.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Hobart.
Finance Committee unanimously recommends.
Discussion, Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Currently, state law limits most contracts to a three-year term. However, town meeting may waive this. Actually, in practice, over the last 30 years, we have been issuing contracts for 3 years with a three-year extension. There's a quasi question as to whether or not this is legitimate or not. What we're trying to do is legitimize it and also allow the Hillview Commission to consider, if necessary, you know, a five-year contract with a five-year option. Keep in mind, you know, we're running an enterprise and a business here. And this has been an extremely successful enterprise for the town of North Reading. For those of you that may not be aware, you know, the revenues from Hillview have actually paid for its acquisition, which was way back in 1988. It's actually paid for the purchase of and development of Ribson River Park, no cost to the taxpayers of the town of North Reading. It's actually paid for and the turf field at the high school. You know, so as it builds up its reserves, you know, the purpose of the enterprise is very limited. It cannot be used to offset any normal operating expenses of the town. So when we set this thing up way back in 1988, it was done deliberately and intentionally to, you know, preserve open space, recreational opportunities, and again not offset operational needs. As we have found, as we've gone out to bid for contracts for operating the golf course, and more recently, the function facility. We have found it difficult to find vendors willing to bid unless the term was in excess of 3 years. Again, some of these vendors have to invest a significant amount of money to operate, and the return on the investment is limited. So with the ability to go beyond 3 years, the enterprise would be far more successful and would probably allow us to have more vendors to entertain when it comes bid time. So the Board of Selectmen unanimously recommends, the Hillview Commission unanimously recommends that you support this article. Thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. McGrath.
Ed McGrath, Long Road. Does this just affect the golf course management pro shop or and or the club out of the other building, the function hall, bar, etc.?
This is specific to the golf course. We already, a couple of years ago, maybe 2 or 3 years ago, had a similar motion before town meeting for the operation of the function hall and pub. Town meeting already authorized that, and right now we're in the middle of a contract of a five-year with a five-year option. So we're looking for the same in relation to the golf course management. So golf course only.
Further discussion? Mr. O'Leary?
The practice has been in the commission, again, I was on the commission for 12 years, and with the guidance from the Board of Selectmen, we're not looking to go beyond a five-year contract with a five-year extension. So that's what it calls for. Again, if a proposal were to come in for something more, it would certainly be considered, but I would not necessarily think that it would be looked favorably upon. So we're looking for.
That's not part of the record.
That is correct. It's just we're looking for beyond 3 years.
Mr. McGrath.
Mr. McGrath, in Wall Road, following this woman's point, so there's nothing formally written in any guideline, bylaw, rule, whatever, that would cap the length of a contract or help you commission. You say that now, and years from now, somebody, the commission might want to make a 20-year contract, so if you want.
It is important to keep in mind that there is a check and balance in place whereby all contracts are signed by the town administrator who answers to the Board of Selectmen. The Hillview Commission makes recommendations only. Makes recommendations only. So it's up to the basically the town administrator.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 39, Mr. Schultz.
Article 39, fund feasibility study for pedestrian bicycle pathway. Mr. Moderator, I move to pass over Article 39 as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion recommendation from the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Schultz.
The Board of Selectmen recommends passing over.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Hobart.
Finance Committee recommends passing over.
Further discussion? Mr. Schultz.
While we are passing over this article at this point, or recommending passing over, I do want to point out the Land Utilization Committee has done a great job, especially Mr. Philip Hertz, in trying to get a bicycle path in our town. We have gone a long way in isolating properties to make this a feasible item. We just thought at this point with the water issue and the Board of Selectmen didn't have the bandwidth to really take on this project at this time. We would like to address the need for a feasibility study probably in the fall. But I just wanted to say thank you to the LUC for the Land Utilization Committee for what they've done on this project today. They've done a lot of work.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 40. Mr. O'Leary.
Article 40, Citizens Petition, Betterments and Road Paving, Swan Pond Road. Mr. Moderator, I move to transfer from free cash the amount of $10,000 to conduct stormwater engineering work required for potential paving of all or a portion of the unaccepted portion of Swan Pond Road and to pay for expenses related thereto.
We have the motion, the recommendation from the Board of Selectmen, Mr. O'Leary.
Board of Selectmen unanimously recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Hobart.
The Finance Committee does not recommend this. We have one abstention. Part of our problem is that we spend a certain amount of time and energy and money on various feasibility studies, but frequently without knowing the funding source will be going through. And so the Finance Committee has been looking quite carefully at feasibility studies and these kinds of instruments, feeling less than comfortable approving something where there's no new funding source. And by this, I do not mean the $10,000 for free cash, but rather the cost of the project. Once this survey is completed.
Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The Board of Selectmen certainly appreciates and respects the recommendation of the Finance Committee, but also respectfully disagrees. What we have before us at Article 40 is a citizen's petition. And this is a group of people not necessarily sponsored by the Board of Selectmen or the Finance Committee or any town board. Board of Commission. This was a group of citizens who were looking to enact a betterment bylaw, which is already on the books, in order to improve the street in front of their home. For those of you, which is probably 99.9% of the community, who have not been up to Swan Pond Road, it's a beautiful area and a wonderful resource, but it also buffers, it's right next to Swan Pond, which is a drinking water supply for the town of Danvers, North Reading, even though it's in North Reading. So therefore, there are some concerns in relation to stormwater management in relation to paving. We meaning the Board of Selectmen, have asked the citizens to petition this to allow us to take a look at what would need to be done in order to effectuate what they're looking to do. It's important to note that we have in North Reading about 5 miles of unaccepted streets that are dirt roads. The Board of Selectmen is unanimous in their opinion that we need to do something about this and need to address it. We also recognize on an annual basis that we have right now currently 22 miles of accepted streets, you know, that need some sort of improvement. But that being said, what we are doing is we are currently, as a community, maintaining these unaccepted streets in the form of, you know, laying some gravel down, crushing run, dragging it out, trying to pack it down. We're also maintaining in the form of snow plowing, trash removal. So we're doing everything in these neighborhoods as we are in every other neighborhood. But the cost of maintenance of these types of streets is getting to the point where it's kind of extraordinary, where it may make sense, where if we can, we should do something in order to maintain these streets in a different fashion. And that different fashion means, hey, you know, we have some sort of restrictions that we're, that we have to be in compliance with. We recognize that. But it's also important to recognize that these people are paying taxes also. We're expending taxpayer monies in order to maintain these roads already, and we need to do it the most cost-effective way. So the board is trying to, from an overall plan, come up with some sort of a solution to address these 5 miles of roads. Swan Pond will be our first. The residents up in the Swan Pond area, in my estimation and in my experience, for the last 20 to 25 years, have been extremely patient in working with the administrations, previous administrations, previous DPW directors, in order to effectuate some change up there in a good, meaningful way, in a cost-effective way. There have been improvements made by the town. We have gone up there and maintained these roads. We have widened them. We have added some additional gravel. We have done some drainage. The town owns a significant portion of land up in this area also. So from a public safety standpoint, from a public health standpoint, it's a good thing to address. So we're looking to address this particular situation first. Because it is adjacent to a public water supply, there's some stormwater management engineering that needs to be done. So the Board of Selectmen is asking for the $10,000 for free cash to determine exactly what needs to be done in this specific area. But keep in mind, we're also looking to, in the short term, address the long-term needs of all the unpaved streets in the community. So while we understand the position of the Finance Committee, and we appreciate it, and we don't necessarily disagree with it, we think that it's important for us as a board to tackle this issue head on and tackle this neighborhood first. So what we're asking for town meeting to do is to give us approval to address the situation that's specific to this neighborhood, and then allow us to again move forward in addressing the needs of the rest of the community that's in the same situation. So I would ask you to please support the motion before us. Thank you.
Mr. Callahan.
The issue I have with this project and the further project that would result after the study is that it takes a road that's an unaccepted road and provides funding for paving that road without going through the process of capital consideration, as all of the projects in this town do. Selectmen formed a capital improvements planning committee half dozen years ago to look at all of the capital projects, evaluate them, and make recommendations to the Board of Selectmen after we've spent time deliberating, understanding all of the needs, understanding the funding sources, and then making recommendations to the Board of Selectmen. I think this ought to fall into that category. I don't think it should automatically leapfrog in front of all of the other projects in the town, certainly not the other road projects in the town. Mr. O'Leary is correct, there are roughly 22 miles of roads that are in need of something. Those are the worst roads. I mean, there are 87 or 88 miles of roads in this town. All of the roads need something in order to either keep them from deteriorating or to bring them back to a state where they are acceptable. I think putting one unaccepted road ahead of all the others without having a plan in place for evaluating all of the unaccepted roads, seeing how the repair or reconstruction of those roads fits in with the rest of the road program is short-sighted, and that's the reason that I'm personally opposed to this.
Mr. Collier.
Just to clarify, you know, we have a bylaw on the books, you know, which allows for betterments whereby the cost of born to improve these unaccepted streets can be shared. There's a question as to whether or not this neighborhood falls into that category, and it has not been. The practice has been where we have done improvements in other neighborhoods through this betterment process, and there have been practices where the town has decided that it is in the town's and the taxpayers' best interest to take care of these neighborhoods, even if the betterment bylaw isn't applicable. So what we're asking for here, because of the fact that it's adjacent to a water supply, which again is a little bit different than probably any other area of the community, it's important that we be able to identify exactly what the costs are going to be to do. And as I pointed out, this community up in the Swan Pond area has been working with the town, not working against the town and not advocating and not coming before town meeting previously, as other neighborhoods have, you know, but working patiently with the town to move forward in this particular project. Because of its proximity to the water supply, it has a unique set of circumstances. We're looking for $10,000 to identify what will actually have to be done in order to offer an opportunity to get this thing done. So again, there's no argument. We have an awful lot of roads that need to be maintained in the community. There are an awful lot of roads in the community that are already accepted. But again, we have 5 miles of road in this community that are not, that we're already maintaining, and it's costing us on an annual basis, probably unnecessarily. I mean, just across the street from my home, there's an unaccepted street. They had to come by twice this year. It's already washed out in the last 2 weeks because of the heavy rain. The money expended to try and maintain these roadways sometimes is not well spent. And it's just because of the conditions of the roads and our inability to address the situation. So the Board of Selectmen is looking for an opportunity, and using this one as an example, but an opportunity, we're gonna take it anyway and address the entire situation. But this particular neighborhood, because of the uniqueness in relation to the adjacency to the public water supply, needs a little additional attention, and we're asking for your support. So we would urge you again to support this. Thank you.
Name and address for the record, I'm sorry.
I propose to the block, I live at 223 Swamp Pond Road. My husband Phil and I have lived at Swamp Pond over 40 years. I support this motion made by the selectmen and do so for the benefit of all the petitioners of Swamp Pond Road. Over the last 20 years, Swamp Pond Road residents have made formal citizen petition paving requests to the town. We have been in queue going back to 1998 and in 2008 after the two other gravel sections of Swan Pond Road were paved. And those were done on a less formal road management program with a 50-50 split between the town and the residents. But anyway, we've been in queue all that time. Unfortunately, our efforts were stalled with each new change in the DPW administrations over the years. So we just recently, in recent months, went before the selectmen. We appreciate the board's support and commitment in making this motion to formally put us on a path to paving. We're also grateful for their recognition of our long-standing efforts and patience. Paving of Swan Pond Road is not only about eliminating the serious negative impact of gravel, dirt, dust, and erosion that has on the health of our families, the reservoir, and its habitat, but from a fiscal responsibility standpoint, paving will save the town taxpayers money by eliminating the regular grading, maintenance cost, material, manpower, and equipment upkeep each and every year. Money that simply washes away with each rain and snowstorm. On behalf of myself and the Swan Pond petitioners, I thank you for listening and sincerely ask for your support. Your approval help tonight would help us move forward. Thank you.
Mr. McGrath.
Ben McGrath, Long Road. I would hope someone could educate the meeting with regard to what is the town's obligation to non-accepted roadways in terms of maintenance, et cetera. Are these private roadways, the public road? I'm asking for an education.
Mr. O'Leary.
There are a multitude of definitions in relation to the dirt roadways in town. Some are private ways, some are publicly accessible ways, some are easements. There are a whole host of situations in the town of North Reading that exists. For the most part, the town of North Reading continues to maintain, plow, and provide trash collection and other public needs to these particular areas. So there's no set definition as to what we're facing here. So what the board is looking to do is to address the situation and as to what is the most cost-effective way of maintaining these particular roads. So we have a whole host of issues that we need to fix, both legal, both zoning, in addition to that, some sort of public records. How do we identify these things? The fact is, we're doing a certain amount of maintenance on these streets already, whether legally, illegally, applied, or anything else. So we recognize and we supporting these particular residents of the community. What we're looking to do now is to do it in the most cost-effective manner. And what we want to do in this particular case, as it's been brought up in the citizen petition, we've asked them not to bring it before town meeting, but to allow us, first of all, to address the specific situation here, which is because of its adjacency to the water supply, to look at the stormwater management. So there's no simple answer to your question.
Mr. McGrath.
A little concerned, Mr. O'Leary. You just said that we're using tax dollars and legal services, so that's concerning. I'm not proud of that. If there's so many of these roads we're spending, PPW spending resources, is there a program? Why is it something we have a general program of what's accepted and what we're going to do? It just seems we're kind of flying by the seat of our pants.
Thank you for your pointing out my poor choice of words. Let's say it's not necessarily illegal. However, whether we should or shouldn't be doing it may be called into question, but there's no doubt that we've been doing it for decades. Decades.
Mr. Klein.
I believe we should be doing it.
Darren Klein, the moderator. Just the simplest way, as Selectman O'Leary said, there really is no simple answer. There's a lot of different facts and variables, laws and local bylaws that all go into the equation. But I guess if I had to give the most simple definition to town meeting, or general definition, is an obligation to provide safe access. And so we do have an obligation to do that even for
private
roads,
I'm
sorry.
So
there's an obligation
to provide
safe access.
Mr. Briscoe, and then Mr. Rowe.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. So it's clear, based on what you've heard from Mr. Kelleher, that
our CIP does a good job. They are only tasked and focused on accepted roads. And we could just call it an oversight, but we need a plan to how to address these unaccepted roads. And because there are a lot of resources being applied to them. And we need to find a better way going forward. And I think tonight is a good way to start the process. We invest in this study. What we learn from this study that we do at Swan Pond, I think will help us learn what we can do on other roads. And it is very expensive to bring an unaccepted road up to the qualifications and standards that we need to be an accepted road. We know that. There has to be a happy medium in between. I think that's what we're trying to do here tonight, is get the money to the pool to do this study, allow the board over the, between now and October town meeting, look at a method and a way to address this for those other 22 miles of roads, or sorry, 5 miles of roads that we have, without losing the commitment to the other 22. We still have to do it. The board has to make a decision. Do we want to start investing more money in accepted roads? I mean, unaccepted roads as much as accepted roads. It's an important discussion we still need to have. So I hope you support this article. It will give us a chance to learn from it and to implement something new.
Mr. Rowe. I can't hear the mic on.
Mrs. Gravato.
members from many years as we've been going through this process. And I appreciate Nolan's being here. His family lives at the end of the road, and we've had discussions about that end of the road. They would not want to participate having the road paved. So the road being paved would just go down to next to the last property. But other than that, I have been in contact with all of my neighbors. Everyone is supportive of the road being paved. And when we get an estimate of what the paving cost would be, then we would work out how that's going to be split with the neighborhood with the 50-50. The other thing I wanted to mention is the serious health effects of living on a gravel road is, if you ever do any kind of research, you would discover serious health effects with the road sediment, with the dust and the dirt, lung disease, lung cancers, the sediment that runs off into the reservoir is harmful for the habitat, and you know, I can go on and on with the negative impact with the health issues. But to me, the most, for the taxpayers, the money that the town spends every year grading the roads, it is just money that's being thrown away. It needs to be done, but you know, it runs off into the reservoir, and it's just not a good situation. I guess that's all I wanted to add.
Mr. Carrara.
Hi everyone, my name is Phil Carrara, and I guess I would like to stress a little bit more about the health problems that are caused by a dirt road. There's phosphorus in the dirt road, which is a natural fertilizer. And as it rains, the silt from the top of the road runs into the reservoir, which is a low phosphorus environment. And what it does is it causes booming in the reservoir. And since we've been out there, I've seen it happen maybe three times. It happened pretty bad about a year ago, I think it was. Rofius talked to the manager at Amherst Water Works, and the winter actually kills the blooming, which is algae in the water. But in the lake, the pond recovers, but you know, it recovers a little weaker than it was before it happened. So I think this is, and I think it's an ecological nightmare for the water itself. As Rosie stated, the Simpsons live at the end of the road. So when we say the road is about 2,700 feet long, we would just stop at the Simpsons property if they don't want to have it done. So everyone else in between has indicated that they do want to have it done. And you know, we would be responsible for getting the 50% of the share from the residents to pay half cost of it. But I think it's, and Rose has mentioned the issues of health to human beings, which is considerable. So I think this is an excellent way to start this process. We wanted to just go ahead and see if we could get it done all tonight, and I think that would have been a little bit unwise and something to talk us out of that, and I think for good reason. So I appreciate the support of the selectmen to get this done. I hope you vote yes on this. Thank you.
Mr. McGrath.
Ben McGrath, the Long Road. How many homes are on this stretch of road at this time? Are they all lots developed? Or
Mrs. Cravato, please wait for the microphone so everyone can hear.
It's 19 properties there.
19 homes or 19 properties?
It's 19, let's see, I believe it's 19 homes. I don't have that particular paperwork.
It looks like 50 to 40 homes.
Pardon me?
My concern, to your point about the environmental, I was wondering if the undeveloped lots there, that if you're going to pave this road, now you're going to have another development. see on my cell phone, there didn't appear to be a lot of homes, but it was a lot of trees, so it was quite a question.
Yeah, no, there's, I think it's 19, there's a couple of cottages. And actually, Swan Pond Road is traveled by more than just its residents every day. We have school buses, you know, trash trucks, you know, all the residents, visitors. Swan Pond Forest is used as a recreational area. We have, you know, bicyclists, you know, walkers, people coming down to the area all the time, so it's well traveled. And furthermore, Swan Pond Road has been in existence going back over a century. It's in deeds going back over a century. There was a land court case in 1950 that ruled that it was a road that would be used for all purposes, all public purposes that are used in roads in North Reading. And so this road is an old road, and it's been around for a long time. And I guess part of it is, I feel like we're not asking, you know, for that much. We're not asking for our road to be brought up to current day standards where we need sidewalks and the road widened. You know, we're merely asking for the road to be paved in the layout that it is. You know, just as simple as that. We just want to be brought in, not into the 21st century. We want to be brought into the 20th century. So, you know, but like I said, the main three issues for us is the health, you know, families with the dirt and the dust and the impact on the pond and the cost of, you know, savings for the taxpayers. Thank you.
Sir.
Jared Eldridge, 207 Swan Pond Road. I think Rosalie has said very well. From a fiscal responsibility perspective, that the constant maintenance of the road...
Right into the microphone, please.
Sorry. I think Rosalie has said very well. The constant maintenance of the road, from a fiscal responsibility perspective, it's expensive. Every dirt road we have is expensive to maintain. And there are obligations the town's been meeting very well. But I think this road we're going to be reducing our tax liability, our actual costs of maintaining that road for longer. What I'd like to see is that we spend our money as well as we can. That we, you know, make the investment early on and make sure that we don't have an expensive process of maintaining the road in the future. As a resident there, I have no personal reason why I would prefer to be paved. But this article in question is specifically about doing the study to understand what the cost would be. This isn't about enabling or disabling us to pave the road or have to try to help fund it. This is about finding out what this month would be. And I respectfully disagree with some of the other neighbors with regard to being too expensive for people in the neighborhood. We don't know how expensive it would be. This is a study that will help us understand whether or not it's cost effective. Thank you.
Answer some questions. Clarification.
Clarification on questions.
Clarification on some of the comments or questions.
All right, Mr.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
A couple of points. First of all, was before town meeting tonight, it's $10,000 to do a study for stormwater management. It's not to do Swan Pond Road, first and foremost. Second, when it comes to whether this area qualifies for betterment or not, which is a 50-50 split, that's to be determined at a later date. So it's important that town meeting understand what we're asking for tonight. We believe that this particular area needs to be addressed and should be addressed along with other areas in the community. What qualifies and doesn't qualify for the betterment will be determined at a later date. You know, but in this particular case, specific case, you know, because of the stormwater management needs, we need the $10,000 to do that. You know, as far as, you know, Mr. Stimson and his family's property, we are well aware that they are not necessarily in favor of having pavement in front of their property. They're at the far end, you know, so that we'd be more than happy to accommodate. You know, so, again, once again, what we're asking for is town meeting to allow the board to appropriate the money, and spend it wisely. What I can assure you at this particular point, only the town administrator, members of the board, is that we will get an acceptance for each resident along the way, because we're going to need this anyway. If we're going to pave it, we're going to need an acceptance for the residents along the way. We will get acceptance in order to survey the properties in order to do a layout prior to expending this money. So we're not going to spend it unwisely. We're not going to spend it unnecessarily without the permission and the buy-in of the residents up there. So what we're looking to do is ask you for the $10,000. We will assure you that we will get the assurance from the residents in signing off and allowing us to survey the properties, their properties. And again, keep in mind, a significant portion of the property up there is town-owned land anyway, along half the roadway. The residents basically own halfway into the roadway. The town of North Reading owns halfway in for probably, 600 feet? 600 plus feet, 600-700 feet. And other portions further down. But so again, we will get assurances and sign-offs from the residents along the way before we spend the $10,000. So again, we urge you and ask you to support the motion. Thank you.
Mr. Delaney.
Water and shot leaks at this road. I understand what this honor is calling for. If I get to the veterans and the 50-50 split, would that have to back before town meeting for approval for the town to share that 50%?
Mr. Gilbert. Through you, Mr. Moderator, in either a scenario where this were to be a traditional betterment project under the town's betterment bylaw, or a project where there would be an upfront cost sharing, which is the more common practice that the town has had for a betterment type project, it would come back to town meeting for an appropriation for construction.
Thank you.
Mr. Evans.
Eric Evans, 3 Sandra Lane. Was there any discussion about splitting the cost of the study? Where you got a 50-50 proposition here, and if not, would that be possible?
Mr. O'Leary.
No discussion, and we weren't asking for it, and we're not proposing.
Mr. Gilbert.
And further, my recollection from reading the town's betterment bylaw, that the town does generally do the upfront work, including the engineering work that's described, before approaching the residents.
Mr. Evans, follow up.
Just as a follow-up, and if there were betterment involved with this, that would be included in the cost and then split at the end.
So you're saying it's not possible to split the cost up front?
I think that's what they're saying.
Correct. Thank you.
Mr. Capizzuto.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Reddick, Capizzuto, 12th Wing Drive. I'm just curious. If any of the health issues or hazards for the roof issue are documented and presented to the town?
Mr. O'Leary.
Officially, no. In other words, there have been presentations by the residents as to studies that have been done and the effects of that type of environment, but as far as a formal study, concerns, recommendations to the town,
Just in reference to the health issues, there's a mineral in the soil that when it's inhaled into the lungs, it has this very similar molecular structure to asbestos, and it also can cause black lung disease. And so I'm not saying that anybody out there has black lung disease, but this is what can be caused by asbestos.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Moderator, should I make some things for the question?
You already spoke on the issue.
Someone else want to make that up?
Phil.
Hi, Elizabeth Ryan, a lot. I'm willing to throw out the question.
All right, we've got a motion to move to the question. All those in favor of moving to the question? question, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? On the main motion, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Motion carries. I will entertain a motion to adjourn. Mr. Prisco.
Mr. Moderator, I move to adjourn this meeting.
We have the motion to adjourn. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Have a great evening, everyone.